It's also the second Sunday in Christmas. And we begin our service as always, sharing joys and concerns with each other. And now we ask that you would hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for the children to come forward. Rehoboam did not listen to God either. He made the people work hard and pay a lot of money to live in his land. The people became tired and angry. Finally, some of them decided to leave and start a new country. God's wonderful kingdom was split in two. One country was called Israel, the other was Judah. There was a lot of fighting between Israel and Judah. Over the years, both countries had good kings who worshiped God and bad kings who worshiped idols. Oh, there's so many things in that picture. Do you see that there's a picture of some of the idols that they worshipped? Mm-hmm. They just, instead of worshiping God who's alive, they worshiped something that was dead, like a stone. All right, many years later, Rehoboam's grandson, Asa, became the king of Judah. Asa was a good king. He loved and worshiped God and got rid of all the idols. King Asa learned from his grandfather's mistakes. You can learn from mistakes and do what is right. You guys ever made a mistake? Yeah, did you make a mistake today, anybody? Probably some of you. Yeah, I made one mistake today. Oh, yeah. Yeah, but you can learn from that. That's right. Okay, so today you have a really special Sunday school craft because Dawn Marie has a youth group junior craft that she wants to do during Sunday school time, and it's a New Year's craft. So we're thankful to Dawn Marie for doing that today. And then next week we'll go into our Sunday school classes. All right, so let's hold our hands. Lord God, thank you for a new year. Thank you for 2016. And thank you that you can help us learn from our mistakes. Help us to have a good time in Sunday school and bless our teachers and our parents and our family. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
He sends his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly. He spreads the snow like wool and scatters the frost like ashes. He hurls down hail like bubbles. Who can withstand his icy blast? He sends his word and melts them. He stirs up his breezes and the waters flow. He has revealed his word to Jacob, his laws and decrees to Israel. He has done this for no other nation. They do not know his laws. Praise the Lord.
And now please hear the scripture lesson from the book of 1 Kings.
From the book of 1 Kings, chapter segments from chapters 11 and 12. Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all of Israel 40 years. Then he rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David, his father. And Rehoboam, his son, succeeded him as king. Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel had gone there to make him king. When Jeroboam, son of Nebat, heard this, he was still in Egypt, where he had fled from King Solomon. He returned from Egypt. When all the Israelites heard that Jeroboam had returned, they sent and called him to the assembly and made him king over all Israel. Only the tribe of Judah remained loyal to the house of David. This is the word of God.
Please pray with me. Lord God, we ask for a special perception of your Holy Spirit in this moment, that you would allow it to speak to our minds and our hearts, that you would apply a message straight into our own lives specifically through the amazing power of that same Spirit. God, we ask that you would help me to speak and to think clearly. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. I bet you have all had this happen. For something similar, where you say to yourself, gosh, I have got to stop at the grocery store on my way home from work to get milk, because we are absolutely out of milk and we cannot go forward as a family, as a household, unless we have more milk. So I'm just going to buzz into the grocery store quickly and grab a few gallons and get on my way home. And then, if you're like me, you pull into the grocery store and you're thinking, you know, what's for dinner? And this is something that I like to do, by the way, is maybe I'll do this tonight, I think to myself as I get into that parking lot. I'm going to go look back at the meat section. And being a person on, you know, a budget with four kids in my household, one of the things I like to do is to go back to the meat section and to look for the meat, not any particular meat, but the one that has the sticker on it that says Manager's Special. Right, the one that's just, it needs to be sold today, right? And so the price comes down. And I like doing that, A, because I'm getting a good deal, but B, because it forces me out of my box of cooking, right? It's not the same old thing. The first time I ever made a London broil, this is why, is because I went and it was on a really good price, and I said, what's a London broil? I haven't done that. And so then I'm on my phone and I'm looking up recipes for London broil, and I see that that's good. Fine. You know, I think some Brussels sprouts would go pretty well with this. I like them. Sam doesn't as much, but let's see if he'll do a healthy thing. This, you know, we'll make this tonight. It'll be good, because if I can get it in the oven by, you know, 4:45, then we should be fine for dinner. It's all going to be great. And then Lucy needs lunchbox snacks, and I get all these things, and I'm driving home, and I pull in, and I'm in time to get it in the oven, and I open my fridge, and I open, and I see the top shelf with no milk. And what don't I have? And the whole reason that I went to the grocery store was for... You've done this. Yes. Okay, we lose our focus, right? We have like one central intent, one purpose, one mission. And then we get distracted by all these shiny objects. The Spicers, I love this. I heard this from Noah, called the shiny object syndrome, SOS. When the little shiny objects get in your way, you're losing focus on that main purpose that you were supposed to be doing all along. And it can happen, too, when you're going to your house after having been away for a little while, if you have other people in your house, and you're thinking, oh, good, or maybe your pet or your animal. I am so happy that I will be home and see those people that I love. And they are wonderful, and I wonder how their day was. And then this is me, you walk in the door, and there's a backpack in the middle of the mudroom, and the shoes are all over the place. Are you kidding me? Because what we do in our house, right, and all my kids know this, whether or not they execute it every day. What we do is the shoes go on the shoe rack, your backpack gets hung up, your coat gets hung up, and you put your lunchbox by the sink. And it's all over the floor, Calvin, and he does this every day. And so then I come and does he not? He's like the worst one. And so then, don't tell him after church, he's gonna grow up to be, you know, I don't know, a different religion. So, come and I see Calvin, go get your stuff off the mudroom floor. This is him. Hang on, I gotta get to a stopping place on my Calvin. Right? Go get it, go do that. And then I go into the house and I get immersed in something else. And then by the time I'm putting the London Broil on the table for dinner, it's 2 hours later, and I realize that I haven't said to Calvin, hey honey, how are you? I love you. How was your day? Which is actually probably my central focus of my relationship with Calvin, right? Is to connect with him, be a good mother to him, support him, love him, encourage him, and not get distracted by the shiny thing, the backpack, in the middle of the floor. But this happens to us all the time. We lose sight of our core mission, our core focus, and we lose the ability to be really effective and excellent at the task that God has given us. God's given us all a task, an assignment in this season of life. It changes in different seasons of life, but every single one of us has that thing. And for us to live into it and do it with excellence is the way that we're a part of what God is doing with us. If we can be clear on what this season has for us as a mission, as a purpose. Losing sight of mission and purpose is what has happened in this section, this chapter 14 of the story. We know that God's people were called to be set apart as a nation of people for the primary and only purpose of showing the world what it looks like to live with God in your life. That is their job. They are ambassadors of God to the world. They are supposed to be different. They are supposed to be set apart. It is their primary, only purpose. And they do all right with that sometimes. They form themselves into a nation, and you remember many chapters ago, they had judges ruling over their nation, and then they finally submit, you know, the judges thing isn't working. Give us a king like the other nations. And so instead of having God as their king, now they have a human king. God goes along with it, because want. They have King Saul, King David, King Solomon, the first three kings. And those kings do pretty well. They have a lot of humanity in them, if you will. But they also try really hard to live with a heart after God's own heart. And so now we're at the time at the end of Solomon's reign. And Solomon has done some awesome things as a part of his leadership. His dad had already built what's the big house? Oh my goodness. Palace, thank you. Cute, please. They built the palace. David built the palace, right? And now Solomon continues in the nation building things. He's levying taxes. He's conscripting soldiers. He's building now a temple, God's house. He has a nice military. He has big treasuries. Solomon has got, what, 900 wives, so he's got to support them too, so he levies some more taxes, right? This is a really big, strong nation, and things are going very well from that standpoint. But on the other hand, this tax burden and this conscription, asking the young men to be soldiers, is really a burden for the people. And the people are starting to really chafe under this. And by the way, this is exactly what God said would happen if they had a king. But God did not go, I told you so. But this is exactly it. The people are unhappy now that they have a king, or this particular king. And so they start to murmur among themselves. And they say, you know, Solomon's getting older. And maybe the next king will back off a little bit. And we'll lighten our taxes. Some of us are feeling this way right now, aren't we? Maybe our next king. Lighten the taxes a little bit. Like, stop taking such a toll out of the average person. And they had hopes about that. There was a man who Solomon had appointed to oversee an outpost, a strategic outpost there in Israel. His name was Jeroboam, with a J, Jeroboam. And Jeroboam had some status in government. He was a respected man, but he also listened to the people around him, who were complaining and saying the taxes are too much, it's too big of a burden. And people thought that he had a good way of listening and a good way of thinking about it. And slowly a group of people start forming around Jeroboam saying, hey, you know, you make a really great leader. Maybe you could go talk to Solomon. You have Solomon's here. Could you talk to him for us and let him know? But as things go politically, suddenly there's gossiping and rumoring, and maybe Jeroboam is trying to usurp the throne, and Solomon gets nervous. And so Jeroboam has to run for his life and runs off to Egypt, and he stays there until Solomon dies. When Solomon dies, his son is named Rehoboam. And I decided, you know how there's fashionable name trends like Dakota and, you know, Caitlin and stuff like that? The Oboams were the fashionable name trend of this time, the Rehoboam, the Jeroboam. What's that?
There were lots of Abijahs.
Abijahs, yes, and Oboams, yes. Jeroboam is the guy who's sympathetic. Rehoboam is Solomon's kid, and he's the one who's ascending to take his father's place at the throne. So Jeroboam comes along with some other people and says, hey, Rehoboam, people are taxed too much, please back off, okay? And Rehoboam has to decide how he's gonna rule. First he talks to his dad's advisors, Solomon's advisors, and says, hey, the people think I should back off with the taxes, what do you think? And these older men are like, that's a great idea. Good, the people will love you forever. You will have their loyalty if you can be kind to them in this way. And then Rehoboam goes and talks to his friends, those guys who are his own age. And they say to him, what? Who do they think you are? You're going to be the king, man? You are a big guy. And in one of the cruder sections of biblical literature, they say, you show those people that your little finger is bigger than your father's waist. Thank you for getting that. That's in the Bible. Yeah. You show them who's boss. You show them that you're a man. Tell them you haven't seen anything yet. Just wait till the taxes come when I'm the ruler. And Jeroboam says, yeah, that sounds good. I'm a big man. And so he says, I'm going to tax you even more. And so Jeroboam and his friends are like, what? You're going to make it even worse on us? Turns out that Rehoboam overplayed his hand. Jeroboam is declared a new king, not in the line of David. A new king. He goes up north with 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel. They secede and form their own country. Now you have two countries. Israel in the north, Judah in the south. Judah made up just of two tribes of Israel with Rehoboam there as king. Now in all this storytelling and all these conversations, you hear me talk about how Jeroboam just knelt down before the Lord and prayed his heart out and said, Lord, what do you have for me? And send me a wise advisor because I need to hear from you. And God spoke in a dream. Did you hear that part?
No.
Did you hear that from Rehoboam's part?
No.
No, I didn't hear anybody. And actually, probably because Solomon wasn't modeling that by the end of his rule either, that consulting with God thing. And what has happened is that both of these leaders, both these kings, both these men, have lost focus on what that central core mission of the people of Israel is to be, which is to mediate God to the world, to live under God's rule so that the world knows what God is like because they're looking at these people. They have totally lost sight of that, and they've started to see all the shiny things in their vision, like who's a big man and how many taxes do we have, which are important issues, but not the central core. They've lost focus. And what this is going to do is start to get in the way of their ability to be part of God's plan in their generation. Now, God's plan and God's purposes are still going forward at this time. God is going to bring salvation to the world. We've been told through the line of David, Solomon, Rehoboam are all great-great-great-great-great-grandfathers of Jesus. That's going to continue. Jesus is still going to come out of that line and bring salvation from Israel to the whole world. God's plans are still going forward. But the ability of these two kingdoms under these two leaders to be a part of what God is doing is greatly reduced because they have lost commitment to their focus and their core. And so what this makes me think about is New Year's resolutions. Because it's January 3rd, and that's what we're thinking of. Did anybody keep any New Year's resolutions yet? Or you lost them all by January 3rd? But we think about resolutions at this time. And how about this? How instead of a resolution, we consider making a mission statement. Something that's going to define the core of what we believe that God has for us right now in this season. So that when we are walking through life and looking at all the options that are being presented to us, that we can say, well, this is what I believe my mission is. This is what I believe the core central assignment for me is in this season. Does that relate or does it not? Is it what God has for me or is it not? The church has a mission statement like that. It's in the front of your bulletin every single day. Probably there so much you don't even see it anymore. But when we make decisions about how to run this church and how we line up our mission, we line it up according to this mission statement so that we don't get lost. We say anything that we do in this church has to fit into this mission statement in some way. And if it doesn't, we need to reconsider that because this is what we believe that God has for us. But what about us on a personal level? So I Googled, how do you make a life mission statement, which is kind of a fun Google search. And I looked at a bunch of different things. And I want to share just a real quick outline. And you can get a pencil for this and take it home and fill it out later on. I think that this could be a valuable tool. The very first thing that we need to do, if we're trying to figure out what our core assignment is in this season of life, is figure out the posture that we want to have toward people. The posture towards people. What I mean by posture is my attitude, my character traits, what I want to convey to the people that I'm talking to. When I meet these people, do I want to always speak with truth? We're going to go with a couple things, maybe three things. Do I want to be kind? Do I want to be gentle? Do I want to be more assertive? Is that something that God is working on with me? What is the thing that you want to have characterized the way that you relate to the people around you? What two things? What characteristics do you want to have? What is your posture? And then secondly, who are those people that have priority in your life? Because I'll tell you, especially with stuff like Facebook and the news on all the time, it is really easy to get caught up in the drama of somebody who's a friend of a friend of a friend and to not notice your spouse sitting right next to you. And it's so easy to get sucked into, again, Caitlyn, we can go with Caitlyn Jenner here. Oh, that's so interesting and fascinating and talk all about that. And forget to attend to your friend right over here who's having their own struggle. Who are the people that God has given you in this season as your priority? It's going to be your spouse. It's going to be your children. It's going to be your parents, your coworkers, your neighbors. Who is it that is your priority in this season of your life? So what is your posture towards people? The second part of it is proficiency. Because all of us are given certain things at which we are proficient more than the average bear, more than the people around us. You are uniquely gifted in something that the world needs, that your family needs, that your coworkers need. You've got that gift and that talent. Will you take some time to pray about this one? Say, God, what have you given me that is really unique in this room or in my family? What is that thing that I need to do to serve with that gift? That can be in your workplace, it can be in the church, wherever. That unique gift that you have is something that God needs for the world around you. And so when you're defining what is my mission and my purpose, it's going to include your proficiencies. The things that you are proficient at, or excellent, or talented at. So your posture towards people, your proficiencies. And then to stick with our P theme, the please gods. Please God, help me to do this. These are the growing edges. These are things we usually call resolutions, right? As part of your mission statement, we're including the stuff that we want to grow on to be better. Please God, help me with the stewardship of my physical body. Please God, help me with the stewardship of my money. Please God, help me not lie. Help me not gossip. Help me go to the doctor when I need to go to the doctor. Whatever it is, please God, help me with this. Because that's part of what God has for you right now in this season too, is growing. So three things to help us just stay right there on that core and that mission and that purpose His compassion towards people, our proficiencies, and our please God to help. Help me. You could call those peccadillos, but I thought that word was too obscure, so I didn't use it. But if you like it, we're using it. If we can stick with that core mission statement, it will really help us to remember things like getting milk at the grocery store. Maybe not that. But it will, like Kevin, this even happened to Kevin today. It made me laugh. How are you, Kevin? I just saw you a minute ago. We were talking, because this is what happens. Kevin and I both show up early. We both have 10 things in our mind. We see each other, oh, hi, how are you? What was I doing? And so we stopped talking about what was time in D.C. and blah, blah, blah. And Kevin's like, paper towels! I was getting paper towels, right? It will help us stay on track with the thing that we're supposed to be doing. It will help us get on board with what God is already doing today. Because just as in the Bible story, God's purposes are still going to go forward. The issue is whether or not you are going to be a part of it. And I don't know about you, but out of all the resolutions that I could make for this year, the most important thing for me is to be a part of what God is already doing. So take some time and pray through those things. People, posture, proficiencies, those things. And ask God to help you form a mission statement so that God can use you in this generation. The title of the sermon is Majoring in the Majors. When you focus on those things, you are majoring the majors. You are not majoring those minor, detailed, shiny things. I pray that God would help you to write your mission statement for 2016. Amen. Amen. Take the elements as you are served for them, and then wait to be dismissed from the table. You can return to your seats by the side aisle. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you were formed the earth, from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our life and salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where Christ was born, and in your signs of witnesses, in every age and throughout all the world, you have led your people from far places to his light. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant, by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dead. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The table is prepared. Please come. It's now time for our offering. Let us pray. God, we're so grateful for you that you help us to have focus and purpose and definition, and to know that we're part of something so much greater than ourselves is so humbling, God. We thank you for that. We ask that you would help us to live a life of gratitude, and that you would receive this offering as one expression of thanks that we give. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, we're going to do that at least one more time. Is that okay? Okay.
announcement from Cheryl Carter. I have requested to make an announcement. Go ahead.
I have a transport wheelchair, a clean commode, and a couple of walkers, and I need to get rid of them. I can't store them anymore. If anybody is in need of this equipment, please tell me after church, so I can. I would rather give it to somebody I know, but if not, I'm going to bring it to the senior center tomorrow.
Okay, so Cheryl Carr has some medical supplies. If you're in need of, she'd like to give them to you. Okay. After church today, we're going to stay and take down Christmas decorations, and you get jewels in your crown in heaven for that. That's all I can offer you. but thank you for staying, if you're able to stay for 20 or 30 minutes after church. Also, we need sign-ups for liturgists next week and coffee hour in 2 weeks, so as you're passing by the sheets on the way out. And Ray, before you make your announcement, Ray has a birthday this week. We need to sing happy birthday to Mr. 93. We do? As we go out into the world to serve in his name, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.